Hello viewers, welcome to another edition of the Connect series. Today we have our guest, Dr. Aman Bhosle, who is a PhD in psychotherapy. Considering that the world will be observing October 10th as the Mental Health Day, and considering the issues around mental health, particularly during the COVID, the lockdown period, we thought of having a chat with Dr. Bhosle. Welcome to the show, Dr. Bhosle. To begin with, what are the main causes that cause mental illness, briefly?
Mental illness is caused by several factors. I mean, you know, we usually break them down into two things. Nature, which is your genetics, you know, what you have inherited from your family, the gene pool, so to speak. And the other is nurture. Okay. Nurture is the second one. How you were brought up. What were the situation that you were subjected to while you were growing up, whether it was how you were treated by your teachers in school, how your family members behaved with you, the kind of social relationships you built while growing up. They tend to have an imprinting quality on your personality and how you become or how you see the world, your perceptions, your fears. They're all affected by the experiences. So therefore, there is nature, which you really can't control because that's in your gene pool. And there's nurture, how the parents, how society itself has brought the child up. So these are the two factors that may affect a person's mental health or rather attitude towards life over a sustained period of time. So there are so many issues. There are issues where there are family disputes. There are issues where the relationship is falling apart, whether they are married or engaged or just dating each other. There are issues of anxiety, anger, stress, feeling stress because of the expectations of the office or of society, or there are money problems. So I would say it's a very eclectic approach that you as a practitioner you need to follow in terms of bringing them heightened awareness about their thinking processes and also sort of teaching them how to adjust with the situation that may be presenting a challenge to them. There are several measures that need to be taken. Firstly, it's important for the client to be aware, to have an understanding of what they are really worried about. It's like if you're a hungry person, you know how hungry you are, right? So the client has to come, share, and the psychotherapist, like me, will talk, negotiate, and introduce new ideas, new concepts, new solutions, but also not do all the legwork for the client. You also want to make them independent thinkers, free thinkers, so they can find creative ways out of their problems and, you know, sort of not feel trapped on an ongoing basis by their terrible bosses, annoying parents, spouses who sort of bully them, etc.
Bipolar disorder associated with mental issues?
Bipolar is just one of the many mood-related disorders. It's also known as a manic depressive personality type. It has several levels, and usually bipolar is treated on an ongoing basis, sometimes on a lifelong basis, by a psychiatrist, because that has something to do with lithium levels in your blood, etc. So one of the many ones. It's the more popular one because nowadays, especially after Sushant Singh Rajput's suicide, a lot of questions about these disorders, everyone wants to know about it. So bipolar is just one of the more popularly mentioned disorders. There are several, there are entire books this thick filled with just lists of disorders that are constantly updated. But, you know, for me, I'm not so excited about finding a label for the disorder. For me, it's really about helping the client correct their attitudes, manage their expectations, improve their communication, heighten their awareness, and improve their interpersonal relationships. Because that's where, on a day-to-day basis, they're going to be facing challenges, and that's where they really want to focus their energies. So that's what I like to.
As you said, in view of the Sushant Singh Rajput case, this bipolar issue has suddenly come into limelight and focus.
Yeah.
Everybody has started talking about it.
Health sector के experts और अन्य देशों के अनुभवों को ध्यान में रखते हुए देश आज एक महत्वपूर्ण निर्णय करने जा रहा है. आज रात आज रात 12 बजे से पूरे देश में, ध्यान से सुनिए, पूरे देश में आज रात 12 बजे से संपूर्ण देश में संपूर्ण लॉकडाउन होने जा रहा है। हिंदुस्तान को बचाने के लिए, हिंदुस्तान के हर नागरिक को बचाने के लिए, आपको बचाने के लिए, आपके परिवार को बचाने के लिए आज रात 12 बजे से घरों से बाहर निकलने पर पूरी तरह पाबंदी लगाई जा रही है।
लॉकडाउन हैज बीन कॉजिंग लॉट ऑफ स्ट्रेस एंड आई वाज जस्ट रीडिंग द WHO स्टैटिस्टिक्स दैट इन द 93% ऑफ द कंट्रीज दे हैव रिपोर्टेड mental illness, mental health issues because of the stress and strain. And India also, some statistics say that one out of 10 persons has mental health issues. So what do you think is causing this sudden spurt in mental related issues?
Well, there are a series of factors really. I mean, the economy has been taking a nosedive for as long as we can remember, since March. So there is the shortage of money, and we all know that when there is no money, people start getting worried, isn't it? Because they have mouths to feed and dreams to fulfill. Another reason is, of course, the isolation that social distancing has started, exacerbating, people not being able to meet their friends, etc. I haven't met a single friend in 7 months, except like this. Like, you and me are friends, we're talking on video call. I've been completely cut off from other people. I live alone. So, even as a mental health practitioner, there are some days where I feel, arre yaar, damn it, I wish I could meet my friends, simple drive or go out for a pizza. But of course, that is, a very challenging thing to do, despite the fact that restaurants are going to be opening very soon, or maybe some have already opened. So social isolation affects people in varying degrees, especially if you perceive yourself through the eyes of others. For example, you don't enjoy your own company. You only enjoy your company when you're among 4 or 5 other people. You enjoy what you become around them rather than who you are when you're alone with your thoughts, with your books, with your Netflix shows, etc. So that kind of social isolation also forces you to really contend with your own thoughts. And sometimes those
thoughts... man is a social animal. Whatever he does,
absolutely,
he basically sort of keeps people, others in mind.
Yes,
the way he dresses themselves, the way, there is a lot of people who can't eat alone. There are a lot of people who don't drink alone.
Correct.
They always require a company. In a place like Mumbai, when all of us keep moving around, in fact, though we have weekend holidays, you have a lot of rush in the local trains, and the traffic is now always, roads are always crowded.
Yep.
So in that kind of a scenario, this forced kind of a house arrest, a lot of people take it as a house arrest.
Pretty much.
And you wouldn't get. In house arrest, at least, you go out, you pocket on a compound, you don't get out. But here, you just don't open the door only, and it has created a lot of stress and strain for the children also, because I was talking to a school program the other day. Mm-hmm. They were saying that they heard a lot of children hanging out of the windows. Mama, I want to go out. Why can't I go out? It took some time for them to come down to settle them, with their lives, and come down to a reality that yes, you cannot go out. But do you think, it might sound like a political question, but do you think the sudden imposition of the lockdown has caused more issues?
Well, the suddenness is extremely debatable, because here we are dealing with an invisible enemy. There is a virus that doesn't have a political agenda. A virus kills everyone without discrimination. It depends on how old you are and if you have any comorbidities. So that's what makes it so unpredictable. And if history has taught us anything, that when we can't predict what's going to happen, we get extremely anxious, angry, and even resentful about the situation. So there is a lack of precedence in most of this generation's lifetimes.
Yes.
For this kind of situation, you can't even touch something without worrying about dying. It's a very unusual situation. It's like being in war times, the way a child who grew up during World War II in a Jewish home had a very different kind of fear that at any moment someone is going to kick the door open and, you know, I'm going to be at the butt end of a gun. So that was a fear every child during World War II grew up with. Similarly, the fear, current fear is, oh, can I go out without, you know, it not threatening my family? There are unknown threats. But the fact is that these have to be dealt with in a practical manner, because when you get emotional about this, you start feeling like a victim. You start feeling like this, you are the only person with whom this is happening, but that's not the case. It is a shared burden in every society, regardless. In America, has even Donald Trump has recently been
diagnosed,
etc. So I mean, it's not just exclusive to a poor person or an apartment complex or a flaw or a religious community or a special interest group. Everyone is under attack by this virus, and we have found some interim solutions. We are still waiting for a vaccine. Russia seems to have one, so hopefully we'll soon have one. So these are difficult times, and it's not just about mental illness. I think it's also about being able to adjust to a new way of social functioning as well. So anytime a human being has to change their habits or change their lifestyle, they feel stressed out, because we are creatures of habit. The more we repeat something, the more it becomes ingrained to our personality. For example, if I've been writing with my right hand all my life, if I suddenly switch hands, I won't be able to even write simple alphabet despite having a PhD. Why? Because I've never used this hand to write. Something so simple. We all learned to write so many years ago. They'll say, you have a PhD, how come you can't write with your left hand? Right? There's been no practice. Similarly, we have a lack of practice with being by ourselves, a lack of practice with not going out every Friday night, a lack of practice with this format, not having, in India, we're very physical as a community. We like our Ganesh Chaturthis, we like our Navratris, even our Thali has so many things in it. We're a very colorful country of extremes and dramas and Bollywood. But this situation has kind of come with a rolling pin and flattened everyone out. So you are left to contend with your own thoughts. So not everyone has happy thoughts in here. Not everyone is able to smile in the face of danger. Not everyone even understands what danger means. So different people will suffer at different rungs of the human experience.
Dr. Bosley, do you think the problem also arises when you start resisting yourself, resisting something from outside is different, resisting a pull and force system is different. When you start resisting yourself, there's the dichotomy in the mind, and then that kind of a stress and strain occurs.
When you're scared of your thoughts, when you're scared of what am I going to do with myself now that I'm all alone, because I've not made myself interesting enough to myself, so I find my own company boring. How are you gonna escape yourself? A lot of people, who'd go for travels, they say that, I enjoy traveling alone, but when I reach the destination, I realize I have brought myself along. I brought myself along with one suitcase. So why do we hate ourselves so much? Why do we misunderstand ourselves? It's because since childhood, all people are conditioned to follow certain dictums, to follow certain structures, to follow certain rules based on what our teachers, our elders, our cousins, our family, our societies, our communities, our financial status dictates. So we are used to seeing ourselves through several of these systems, to several of these criterias. But the fact is, a criteria varies from place to place, from time, from which year you were born in, and what were the values of that era versus what were the values of the era your parents were born in or your grandparents were born in. But what happens is, thought processes and habits don't get updated the way fashion does or hairstyles do.
Also, I think the last virus attack that we had, or the swine flu, it did not cause this kind of a damage, this kind of a devastation as COVID is causing.
Right.
That could be that's where I think the expectations and everything began to go for a toss. But getting back to our social tensions and issues, mental health issues, I think the new normal has taught us a lot of lessons. Is not only the way we live, the new normal that is called, the way you work from home, you distancing that you have to observe. You have to be doubly careful with when you meet people, when you greet people from outside. Other than that, including the upbringing, now that we are elders, we have children. So that way, I think we need to look at children, look at their mindset. That also requires a relook. Don't you think so?
Of course. 100%, man. I mean, see, children are like wet clay, I would say. It's a very silly example, but you know, you can mold them. You can
mold,
you can kind of shape their expectations. You can kind of give them something to work towards. So what happens is a lot of adults really screw up the process because, you know, their own upbringing has been dubious. So I always say this, that not all parents deserve to be mentors. Because even two squirrels can produce a little baby squirrel, you know. even two dogs on the street can produce a little puppy. So to procreate requires no special skill. So you become a parent even if you're a dolphin. Okay. Yeah. So but what is your role as a parent versus what is your biological function of just having produced the kids? Really, that is what affects how a child grows up. So are you instilling your child with confidence or are you burdening them with rules? Are you bullying your child because they can't fight back and as a scapegoat because you're having a frustrated marriage with your husband or you hate your in-laws? If a child comes in front, you start shout at the child, you're so stupid. You're like everyone from your father's side of the family. You say something like that. What are you doing? What are you causing? So a lot of adults have not figured out how to deal with their own adulthood. So they kind of make their children pawns. Or they burden their children or force their children to do things that they couldn't do because they want to live vicariously through their children. So here's the thing. When it comes to children, please let children be children. Support their natural abilities. Give them as much exposure as possible. And don't condemn any emotion that they're experiencing. If they're experiencing an emotion, help them come to terms with it and find a sensible way forward instead of saying, how can you cry? You're a boy, only girls cry. Or if a girl shouts, how can you shout? Girls don't shout. True. Otherwise, if you shout, tere se shaadi kaun karega? So don't tell them what is the right emotion to feel. Don't tell them, don't mistrust your child. If your child is telling you something, is opening their heart to you, don't stamp on it just because you don't have time or you don't have enough money or because you are frustrated with your social life because you're locked in your house. A child is very, very vulnerable. So you can take clay and you can turn it into a beautiful pot. You can turn it into something, a sculpture, but you can also take it and step on it and make it flat. And then it becomes part of the rasta.
So I think it's the issue of giving wrong examples or trying to compare your child with your childhood or somebody else's child, you know.
Absolutely. You cannot... If you grew up in the 1970s and your child is growing up in the 2000s after 9/11, these are two very different societies, okay? Yes. Your child will not have seen a world without the internet and iPads, okay? And you had to write letters and send... telegrams, and you've come from very different era, so they may not have an ability to wait for things. They may want everything instant. There's an app for everything. There's an app for love. There's an app for food. There's an app for movies. There's an app for everything. But when you grew up, you didn't have an app. You were given one ball which you had to share among all your siblings, and you were given one wooden stick you used to take and go down, and everyone running with sticks. It was a very different world. So don't say, hamare zamane mein, in our times, we didn't have money. And now look, you have money. So you worked for that money to give that child a better lifestyle, isn't it? So you cannot keep bringing up the past to contextualize the present. Sometimes you need to contextualize the present based on the factors that govern the times that we are currently living in, not, you know, the past.
So I think that the process of learning, you know, has to continue.
Yes, absolutely.
Child is learning. As adults, we have to learn. When I become a grandparent, I have to learn how to deal with my grandchild.
Absolutely.
At the same time, I will be dealing with my son and a daughter at the same time, that it with my wife. I think this process of, like you said, like you reboot, recharge your mobile or, you know, whatever your phone that you have,
100%.
App. So that, I think, and also as you keep experimenting with new apps, whether it works or not, I think that process continues in real life as well.
Absolutely, and that is the secret to good mental health, to keep yourself physically fit, to keep yourself emotionally fit, to manage your expectations, to alter your attitudes, to build a good network with people who you can rely on, to share, to collaborate, to grow, to upgrade your skills, to learn new things, to have a curiosity, to have, as you said, to have a curious appetite, yeah, and to have a desire to learn and sort of, you know, do new things.
Another thing is this issue of learning from home, you know, like working from home is creating one issue. Learning from home is actually doubling the stress at home. Therefore, I'm glued to my laptop, my mobile, for my work or whatever, and the child is at home. She gets her, he or she gets her homework, her classes. You know, this added strain is adding to the mental stress. Have you come across any such cases?
Yeah, parents are having trouble get their kids to, you know, sit in front of the laptop and not multitask. So when your class is going on, are you playing a game on the side, or are you chatting with your friends on the side, or are you checking your Instagram on the side? So that kind of policing. Yes, the parents feel ki yaar, the child is not, you know, focused, or is, you know, spread out across several activities and is not doing any one activity with concentration. So this is a challenge.
Yeah.
But I would argue to say that even if your child was going to school and in a live classroom, they would still be distracted by looking at some classmate or looking outside the window, you know, or maybe they'll check their phone below their table. So that tendency has nothing to do with the child being at home. So that would have happened anyway. Human beings are distractible. If you are not entertaining them, or you're not informing them in a nice, succinct manner, or you're boring the hell out of them, as a speaker, as a teacher, as a school, as an education institute, then you have lost them. Because now, in society, people have very short attention spans. Because they have constantly, there's some buzz going on their WhatsApp groups, on Snapchat, Instagram alert. So it's like a, it's like being constantly tuned into the stock exchange. Arey, ab kya hua? Abhi kitne point upar gaya? Abhi kitne niche gaya? So it's like this information stock exchange that we are a part of.
True.
So a lot of people have, and this is this is not going to go away anytime soon. I don't think so, at least.
Yeah.
So the parents now are just subjected to that. They didn't see their children do this as much before, but because you are constantly in each other's faces, every small, you know, every small annoying habit is now that much more amplified and visible, because you are constantly spying at each other. You know,
so I think we need to understand that the importance of empathy.
It's hard for them too, you know. It's very hard for the children as well, if they can't go down to play, or even if they want to go down, but you know, their parents are paranoid, don't meet this friend, because this friend's grandparent may have had COVID, and you know, so for them as well, it's very, very strange. Because you see, children don't have a precedent. Like, if you have been through stress in your life, in your past, and then you come into this COVID situation, you say, yeah, stress is not something I am a stranger to. I remember the stress I went through. I remember how it felt when I was, you know, struggling. But children don't have anything to fall back on, because they're just, they're so young. They're 7 years old. So what have they seen in those 7 years? They may not even remember four of those 7 years. So it's like when you have a huge library of books, you can pull out any book and find out, acha, this is what I need to refer to. But when you have only one book on one subject and you need to learn 10 different things, you're like, oh no, but this book is not teaching me this. So that's why children are that much more vulnerable and require that much more support and patience and love and care and curation and attention from their families, from societies, and even from their
schools. When you try to pressurize them too much, I think they're bound to revolt.
Yes.
And this generation, this current generation, revolts much more than what I used to revolt, or probably you revolted during your childhood. As you said, because of they're exposed to various things in life, the speed with which things are happening is totally different.
Right.
So in that kind of a situation, what kind of advice do you give to parents?
Be kind and patient and empathetic, and be communicative. Don't expect your child to be a mind reader. Your child is not a magician. Your child lacks context and your child lacks experience. and your child lacks bargaining power, and your child may not be a very eloquent communicator. So it is your job as a parent to show leadership through a situation which can be seen as a crisis situation. This is a crisis situation, isn't it? The way if a ship is sinking, the captain of the ship has to take over and give instructions to people, right, saying, okay, we need to get these many lifeboats ready, we need these many hands on this part of the ship, and this needs to happen so that the logistics of survival can be worked upon. So as a parent...
No, but as a leader, as a parent, when I am myself stressed,
yes,
you know, it could be, as you said, the loss of job, the pay cut,
yes,
not kind of things not happening the way I wanted. So I am under pressure. See, I am pressure from my side, but also I will look
right,
at my
right,
children's pressure also.
Correct.
So how do I adjust to that pressure?
Well, you need to accept the fact that you are not feeling pressure independent of what everyone else is feeling. You are feeling pressure just as everyone in society is currently feeling pressure, just as everyone.
So you're not alone.
You're not alone.
You're not alone.
You're not alone. Take comfort in that. Okay. I know it's not enough to go on, but the fact is that we have to be comfortable with discomfort. Even if there was no coronavirus, there would be 120 things that could make you uncomfortable, whether it's a crowded train or it's a traffic filled highway, or whether it's police brutality in the US making people living in Dadar feel uncomfortable and they're tweeting about it. Oh my God, what's happening in the US? So we as human beings are constantly looking for problems to solve or become a part of. Why? Because we want to feel engaged with our society, with our community, with the world. And we want to also prove and showcase to our circle that, look, we are extremely opinionated. We're extremely aware. We're clued in. That we're not fools, you know, we're not just living for ourselves. We have some kind of community responsibilities as well. So people also want to create a good impression for themselves. So we will always, as a species, look for things to jump into.
When it comes to mental stability or mental health is concerned,
yep,
like watching too much of television, watching too much of violence, etc., on the screen, like. I remember one school principal telling me, because the SSC results that year were not too good because of too much of television.
Achha.
Today, they're not too much of television, too much of violence, too much of screaming, screeching. There's all kind of things that have disturbing things that are happening all around. In fact, my family doctor told me, don't watch television news before you go to bed.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
So I think even the lifestyle, the way you bring up your children, the way you conduct yourself at home, you watch news, you make your children habituated to certain television programs, entertainment, all that also matters. Don't you think so?
I feel television or YouTube or Netflix has a limited role to play as opposed to the role the family plays. So if your father shouts at your mother at the dinner table because he feels the food that she has made is too spicy or too oily, or the roti has become cold, that can damage the child more than if he's watching an action movie with Sylvester Stallone killing 100 Mexicans with a machine gun. Okay, so I believe what a child sees in their house, in their school, with their friends, with their elders, has a far more stronger imprint. Yeah, I'm not saying watch Arnab Goswami or anyone, you know, on their shows, they're always talking very loudly, very passionately. That's fine. See, that man also has a show to run. A lot of people treat him like he's some kind of, some kind of fool. He's not. He's a very smart and strategic television news anchor. This is his style. This is his USP, that when he shouts and screams and yells, that is his debate style format. Okay.
And he does what sells.
He does what sells, absolutely. There's a demand for it. If you weren't watching his channel, he wouldn't be shouting so much. So it's, as I said, it's always a double-edged sword, really. So it's very easy. You know, when I was growing up, people used to blame MTV, etc. Oh, this is the MTV generation. They think India are becoming westernized. See, I think we can learn something amazing from every culture. You can learn something amazing from the Spanish people, from the Japanese people, from Islam, from the Gujarati community. You can learn if you want to learn, and you can be very, very close-minded if you say, no, my culture is the best, my country is the best, my community. That's
So I think not having an open mind also causes, obviously causes mental problems.
That is the biggest cause. Yeah.
I think that's the solution.
So towards, yeah, exactly. That discussion, so absolutely.
That is the solution.
Exactly. So a lot of people, you know, they get very angry, you know, like China, we hate China, Pakistanis. Yeah. And ask those people, how many Chinese people have you met in your life to hate them so much? Not even five. And somebody living in Mizoram doesn't count because that's in India. It's not in China. They look a little, they have those what they call the Asian features, you know. But that,
Mongolian,
whatever. So, but that has nothing to do. They speak probably as good Hindi as you do. So here's the thing. Increase your exposure. Increase your appetite for learning. Don't be so typeset in your ways. And pass that enthusiasm and curiosity to the next generation as well. Okay, your child can play violent video games, but if he sees his father being violent with his mother, I would say the father's behavior will affect him more than a video game, because my child is also not an idiot. He also knows it's unrealistic and that he's killing zombies or aliens, or he's fighting in a war with a machine gun. An AK-47 is so heavy, you may not even be able to carry it. It's so loud, one bullet shot and you can go deaf in the ear.
I know, yeah.
Okay.
You know, I grew up watching this Dennis the Menace, comics.
Right.
So one of the comics is that Dennis tells his mother, "Hey, don't shout at me. I'm not your husband."
Absolutely. I mean, they had Dennis the Menace. We also had Lord Krishna, who was going climbing up and stealing makhan. Children are naughty. Yeah. Children are curious. Yeah. When Lord Krishna does it, it's Krishna ji ne makhan churaya. But then when someone else does it, they're like, your child goes and puts his hand in a jar of honey, you'll say, "Arey, what a stupid child he is," and all. And make sure you take good care of your body.
Yeah. You know, as they say, the saying goes, you live only once. But I don't think so. You live every day. You die only once.
Absolutely. So well said. 100%. You die only once.
So, Dr. Aman Bhusre, thank you very much for your time. We had an excellent chat. I'm sure our viewers also really like it. And thank you very much for your time.
It's a very labyrinthian topic. You understand? It's a very labyrinthian. Yeah. It's a very diverse topic, you know, mental health. In just the limited time we've had, we've not been able to cover everything. But if I was to quickly summarize for our viewers what they really need to do in order to live happy lives, is first, never lose your sense of curiosity. Never, ever, ever feel that you have learned everything and that you're better than everyone. So the second point, please don't be arrogant about what you know, because there's always someone smarter, younger, faster, with better resources than you, who's going to come after your pot of gold. Three, please be kind to your kids, okay? They don't have the experience, the bandwidth, or the leverage to be able to really get what they want. So they're going to try to do it in silly ways, okay? Point number four is, if you feel like you are stressed out or things are not working out, please go and talk to a therapist. Please find a therapist who you are comfortable with, who meets your expectations, who has the right, who, most importantly, not the pseudosciences, you know, like crystal healing, all these things. I mean, it can go either ways, you know. Go with someone who has a degree in this subject, okay? Because there are a lot of quacks, there are a lot of people passing off as healers who are actually just trying to make a quick buck off you, okay? And point number five is, build a network of people who you can rely on. You don't need to have 25,000 friends. You can have even four friends, but they're such good, high quality, caring friends that if you were hospitalized, you know, at least one of those four friends would be at the hospital before your ambulance reached there. So it's very good to build good relationships as well. Despite the fact that you can't leave your house, you can meet new people through WhatsApp, join groups, on LinkedIn you can become a little more aggressive, give recommendations, ask for recommendations. So create a good network of goodwill. And these will...
Also, I think you need to build have a passion and pursue it.
Absolutely. Find what you love, love what you find.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Doctor.
My pleasure.
Thank you, viewers, for your time, for watching this program. We will soon be getting back to you with another interesting program. Thank you very much. Bye-bye, Doctor.
Bye, guys.